Side as well as from Toffee's side. So today, like, he is our guest for today. Like, he'll be staying here for a couple of months and he'll be appearing daily live. Okay, right. So as I said, today we'll be having this live session. So we'll have a virtual classroom session on the topic zinc phosphate cement. So what we'll plan and do is, initially we'll try to complete off this, the summary of the entire cement. And later, we'll have textbook discussion as well. And in that textbook discussion, we shall have some multiple choice questions discussion also, right? So we'll make this entire session into two. We'll just break it into two. So for the first 20-30 minutes, we'll have an overview of zinc phosphate cement. And in the second part of this session, we'll go through the textbook literature, Phillips, and also let's discuss few multiple choice questions, right? And that's how we're planning today's session. So a very good evening once again, right? So shall we start then? Hi Shreesh, a very good evening. Bernice, Nidhi, Pooja, hi Regina, hi Ashina. I hope it is streaming live now. Yeah, Esmega, Gina, Prithvi, Pritika, Bernice, Saida, hi Ramesh, yeah, hi Abhishek, Hi Kumari, a very good evening. So as you all know, zinc phosphate cement is one of the oldest luting cements. So it is considered as a gold standard on which newer materials are being compared. The moment you have a new luting cement, so we'll try to compare its properties with that of zinc phosphate, which means that zinc phosphate cement has set standards and it's considered as the basic material or the standard material with which newer materials are being compared. And the most important use of this zinc phosphate cement is luting. So that's the purpose for which it was introduced initially. It's also called as crown and bridge cement, as it is mainly used for luting purpose. So luting is nothing but fixing the processes to a prepared structure. And the objective of luting is to seal the interface rather than adding up to the retention of a given processes, right? So zinc phosphate cement is the oldest known luting cement. So we have a few points to discuss over here. We'll try to have an overview of the entire cement, and as I said, we'll follow that with textbook discussion. So coming to the composition of zinc phosphate cement, it's always quite easy to remember the composition of any cement because the name itself gives you some clue, right? So we'll just start with composition. So zinc phosphate cement it's available in form of powder as well as liquid. I hope you're all familiar with that, and you might have used it very much thoroughly in your preclinicals as well as in your clinicals. So powder, it mainly contains 90% of zinc oxide, 10% of magnesium oxide, right? And liquid contains water, phosphoric acid, and liquid also contains aluminium phosphate and zinc phosphate. And it's also mentioned in Phillips that the acid content is 33% or 33 plus or minus 5% by weight. So this is the amount of acid that's present by weight in a given liquid of zinc phosphate cement. So this composition is very important. And if you observe, zinc oxide is the main ingredient in case of the powder, whereas in case of liquid, you have water which is available in bulk, which is present in a main composition, but the chief ingredient is phosphoric acid. And remember, the role of water here is very important. So water, it controls the ionization. So water controls ionization of phosphoric acid, thereby it controls the rate of reaction. This is very, very important. So as you can see here, we have base there and acid here. So this is basically a kind of acid-base reaction. And this acid-base reaction, or any acid-base reaction, happens in the medium of water or in any aqueous medium. And this water controls the dissociation of phosphoric acid, thereby controlling the rate of reaction. And this is very important because loss of water, and how do you translate that clinically? So when there is loss of water, so obviously it takes more time for setting. On the other hand, when there is addition of water or whenever there is moisture contamination during manipulation, there can be acceleration of setting because water, as I said, controls the dissociation and also speeds up the reaction or influences the rate of reaction. So role of water is very, very important, right? So I hope it's clear. This is pertaining to the composition, right? And also let me know if at all there is break or if it's not streaming fine. Okay, I'll just take a break accordingly. Okay, right. Hi Farhin. So after completing the composition, the setting reaction is very simple to understand, and it's also very important equal. So basically it's an acid-base reaction. So the powder liquid ratio is, we take 1.4 grams of powder to 0.5 ml of liquid. So this is the recommended powder liquid ratio. And as I said, since it's an acid-base reaction, it happens in a medium of water, and water controls the rate of reaction. Okay? So this is pertaining to composition and setting. So after this, we have working time and setting time. Working time and setting time. So the working time value is approximately 1.5 to 2 minutes, and the amount of time that is dedicated to mix each increment of cement is around 15 to 20 seconds. So all these values are from Phillips, so you can just memorize them, make a note of them, right? So the working time is 1.5 to 2 minutes, but we mix it in the form of increments, right? So the amount of time which is dedicated to mix each increment is approximately 15 to 20 seconds. Whereas setting time is 2.5 to 8 minutes, right? So this is a working time and setting time. And I'm quite sure you're all familiar with the definitions and the meanings of working time as well as setting time. So working time is nothing but a time elapsing from the start of mix till you have this proper luting consistency. Luting consistency in the sense, according to ADA specification, the thickness of luting cement or the luting thickness or the film thickness has to be less than 25 microns. So this is very important. Then you consider that as an ideal luting agent or a luting cement for that matter. So working time is the amount of time right from the starting of mix till a workable mass or a cement in luting consistency has been obtained, so that when you apply pressure, right, so the material has to be, or it should be able to flow within the amount of available space between the crown and the processes. So that's working time, and the duration, I mean the amount of working time which we have is 1.5 to 2 minutes. Whereas setting time is the amount of time starting from the elapse of mixing till the material becomes stronger, or when the matrix formation is beginning. In the sense, when you start mixing it, the material hardens and it no longer undergoes any plastic deformation when you apply external physical force or pressure. And this is a time where you have to remove excess cement. So this is very important. So working time and setting time, I'm quite sure you're all familiar with the meanings, right? But here, the most important thing which we need to focus is, how do we clinically increase the working time and setting time? Because the longer the working time we have, the more convenient for us to work and to complete off our clinical procedure in that particular period of time, right? So how do you increase the working time and setting time clinically, and what are the different means that are available? So just write down here, methods to increase working time and setting time. So the first one, by decreasing powder liquid ratio. So obviously when the powder liquid ratio is decreased, the setting time prolongs, the amount of, because the amount of powder that's available to form matrix is minimal, right? So as a result, the amount of time required to form matrix increases, hence the setting time as well as working time increase. But this is not a recommended procedure, because once you alter the recommended powder liquid ratio, the recommended powder liquid ratio is something like this, but if you try to decrease it, so there will be compromise in properties of the cement, which is very, very important. This can lead to decrease in compressive strength and various other mechanical properties like modulus of elasticity, or it can be even tensile strength. So all these properties will be compromised if the powder liquid ratio is altered. So this method of increasing working time and setting time is not recommended. However, theoretically or for literature point of view, just going through for sake of completion. So clinically, this is not acceptable. So second method, mixing in increments. Third method, prolonging spatulation. And fourth method, and the most commonly recommended method, is cooling off glass slab. Right, so these are some of the means which are recommended to increase working time as well as setting time. Yes, pretty definitely, I'll repeat that after we just complete all of this, right? Yeah. So as you can see, the first method is not recommended because if we proceed with that, there can be compromise in the properties. And the second method is mixing in influence. That's what we do clinically, right? We take powder first, liquid later, just before mixing. We divide the powder into small increments and then add up smaller increments first, right? So this method of adding up smaller increments is with the objective of providing the powder gradually to the liquid so that matrix formation takes some time, and also simultaneously more amount of powder can be incorporated. As a result, the physical properties improve. So by adding up or by mixing in increments, what we're trying to do is we're trying to in fact delay the matrix time formation, the amount of time that's required for the matrix to form, right? So mixing in increments is an accepted or acceptable procedure clinically. That's what we also practice. And also prolonging spatulation. So this is very, very important. If you prolong spatulation, the matrix is destroyed, so it takes longer time to reform the matrix. So that's quite logical to understand. But the same prolonging the spatulation in case of gypsum products, it in fact decreases the setting time. Here, prolonging the spatulation increases the setting time in case of zinc phosphate cement. But in case of gypsum products, prolonging the spatulation decreases the setting time. Why? Let me just leave out that question for you. Try answering that in the live chat. Okay? We'll just have a discussion regarding that later. And coming to the final procedure and recommended procedure, cooling of glass slab. You know what? This is acid-base reaction. So any acid-base reaction by nature is exothermic in nature. So the rationale here is when you cool the glass slab, you're trying to retard the reaction because it's an exothermic reaction. So when you cool it, not below the dew point. Again, if it is below the dew point, there can be moisture formation, which will again accelerate the setting, as we have seen previously. So we have to cool the glass slab so that we can retard the chemical reaction so that the setting time and working time increase proportionally. So these are some of the acceptable methods, except the first one. And remember, in case of setting, as I haven't mentioned that previously, so when powder and liquid are added in this proportion, the liquid, especially the phosphoric acid, attacks the powder, which includes zinc oxide and magnesium oxide, thereby leading to release of these cations into the aqueous medium. As a result of which, there is a formation of a gel-like structure, which is nothing but zinc aluminum phosphate gel. So the final set matrix is something like this. So let me just use another color, so that will be easy for you. Yeah. So once the setting happens, you will have unreacted zinc oxide particles which act as fillers, this is very important, surrounded by a cohesive amorphous matrix of zinc aluminum phosphate gel. So this has been described as cohesive amorphous matrix. So this is the final appearance of a set cement. You can see filler particles in green color, which are nothing but unreacted zinc oxide surrounded by this cohesive amorphous matrix containing zinc aluminum phosphate gel. So this is the final structure. So the final structure of set cement has, we should also try to understand that, right? Because based on that, based on its appearance, we can speculate how the reaction is happening. So all this can be observed SEM through scanning electronic microscopic images, which are given in your textbooks. I mean, it's not given for zinc phosphate, it's given for your GIC if you observe, right? So this is in brief regarding the setting reaction. And also we have certain physical properties to discuss. The values are very important. We have no other choice rather than to memorize them. So coming to physical properties. So I think we have some space here. Right. So let me just write down here. I hope you can see it. So coming to various physical properties. So the only properties which we are concerned here is regarding solubility and regarding compressive strength, tensile strength, and modulus of elasticity or stiffness. Because where do you use this luting cement? We use this luting cement to lute or fix a crown in posterior region or in stress bearing areas. So in stress bearing areas, you should have better physical properties and also least solubility at the margin. So these are the physical properties which we are going to discuss now. So the compressive strength, of zinc phosphate cement is maximum of 104 MPa. The diametral tensile strength is very low comparatively, which is 5.5 MPa. And stiffness or modulus of elasticity, which is also called as stiffness, is approximately 13.7 gigapascals. So this is comparatively high value, 13.7, and as a result of which the material is resistant to elastic deformation, hence it can take up various masticatory forces during flexing, hence it can be used as a luting cement for posterior crowns, right? So these are some of the physical properties, right? And regarding solubility, solubility is very low, as given in textbook. However, solubility in vivo, so whatever values they are given here, they are based on in vitro tests or lab tests, right? But in vivo, the behavior of cement is totally different because of numerous factors acting on it. So even though solubility of the cement is less, in vivo there can be more soluble, there can be increased solubility when the cement is exposed to the oral environment, especially at the margin. That's very important. And also it's mentioned that these zinc phosphate cements are more soluble in dilute organic acids like lactic acid, acetic acid and citric acid. this guy is disturbing me. Hey, why are you disturbing me? Huh? You want to listen? Okay, I'll teach to him also then in that case. Do you want to listen? Okay. Chalo. So that's pertaining to the properties, the physical properties, including the solubility, right? And then we have retention. So what do you think the retention is? So is it mechanical, chemical, or micromechanical? This is very important because the previous concept is that this zinc phosphate cement doesn't chemically bind to tool. So it relies only on mechanical retention, only on the irregularities which are present within a cavity. But also remember that in zinc phosphate cement, we have phosphoric acid. Don't you think that phosphoric acid has the ability to etch the surface of a cavity, as a result creating microporosities, which can lead to micromechanical retention? So there can be etching possible and there can be micromechanical retention as well. That's the reason why it's indicated in textbook that any surface or any substance or any pulp protecting agent like varnish, if applied in a cavity before placement of zinc phosphate cement, can alter or decrease the retention of the cement. I hope you got it, right? So for example, you apply varnish, right, in a cavity before placing zinc phosphate cement, but applying varnish can decrease the retention of zinc phosphate cement. But even then, we're applying varnish because it's nothing but risk versus benefit. If you don't apply varnish, the risk is more than the benefit, because you think that we need more retention and you don't apply varnish, then what about phosphoric acid? Don't you think it has the potential to go and harm your pulp? So we have this risk versus benefit. So based on that, we go apply varnish, right? So that's the literature given in your textbook with respect to retention. So retention is mechanical in nature, it's not chemical, and any pulp protecting agent once applied can potentially decrease the retention of zinc phosphate cement. Also keep in mind that since we have phosphoric acid, it has a potential to etch the surface, which can lead to microporosity formation. Thereby, there is a potential for micromechanical retention. Right, this is just for your information. And coming to biological properties. So biological properties, they're very important because the only thing we're dealing with in biological properties is pH. So the pH of cement within 2 minutes is 2 approximately, so within 2 minutes. And within 2 hours, the pH is 5.5, which means that the cement has a very low pH and there can be potential for pulp damage or irritation. So that's very, very important. So the pH values are very important, right? You can just make a note of them. And finally, coming to manipulation. So I'm sure you're all masters in manipulating zinc phosphate cement, as you have done that n number of times in your undergraduate. So we just take a glass slab, a cool glass slab, and glass slab should not be cold below the dew point, or else if there is, for example, if you place it in a freezer, if there is water droplet formation, so that water can accelerate the setting, right? So it has to be cooled, but not below its dew point. That's very important. So there shouldn't be any water droplet formation. It has to be cooled. That's it. So you take a glass slab, take powder first and liquid later. You can again have a question here. You take, I mean, as we discussed yesterday's morning live session regarding mixing of these impression materials, we like alginate, we take water first, powder later. But here we take powder first and the liquid later, because if you take liquid first, the water present in the liquid can evaporate, which in turn decreases or influences the properties of cement. That's very, very important, right? These are minor things, but they play a major role and they create a major impact on the properties of cement. So glass slab, powder first, liquid later, or liquid just before mixing the cement. And then you mix the cement increments over wide area. Since it's an exothermic reaction, you have to mix over a wide area so that there will be dissipation of heat, right? And each increment has to be mixed for 15 to 20 seconds, and the overall mixing time is approximately 1.5 to 2 minutes, right? So that's actually a mixing time, we can say. So working time will be a bit more than mixing time, obviously, and less than setting time of 2.5 to 8 minutes. That's quite logical to understand and correlate, right? And once you start mixing, depending upon the consistency which is needed, like you want fluting consistency or you want putty-like or base consistency, you add powder accordingly, right? And finally, once you apply this fluting consistency, it has to be used before it becomes hardened, and it has to be placed inside the crown. Half of the crown has to be filled inside with this fluting cement, and you place it over the prepared tool and firmly apply that with pressure, and keep the pressure for some time until the cement sets, and the excess cement has to be removed once the setting is complete, right? Approximately 2.5 to 8 minutes. And you apply a layer of Vaseline or varnish along the crown margins in order to protect the matrix so that it matures with time and it will have more resistance to dissolution against oral fluids. So these are some of the tips for manipulation. Also, you can expect some kind of patients from this part as well. So this is in brief regarding zinc phosphate cement, the entire summary, right? As Preeti has asked previously, like we have, what did Preeti ask? Like the role of water. So water has an important role. It controls the ionization of phosphoric acid in H+ and HPO3. So it controls the ionization of phosphoric acid. Since it is controlling the ionization, only when phosphoric acid is ionized, the acid can go and attack the powder particle. So indirectly, water is influencing the rate of reaction. No water, or once the water is lost, setting time increases. But if you add up more water, or if there is like moisture contamination, there can be acceleration in the setting or decrease in setting time. Preeti, I hope it's clear. Right, so I'll just wait for 2 minutes. I know I've been going on continuously without any break, but since I felt like it's a comparatively easy topic for everyone, so I just didn't give you any break, right? So I'll just break for 2 minutes and I'll take up your questions, and then I'll summarize once and for all entire topic in 5 to 10 minutes, okay? Now I'm sorry for blocking the way. Yeah. Compressive strength is 104, tensile strength 5.5 megapascals, whereas stiffness or modulus of elasticity is 13.7 gigapascals, right? Yeah. Oh, Anu, you lost phone. Okay. Glad that you joined us live at least now. Yes, very good, Abhishek. Yes, Nidhi. Yeah, so Abhishek, you say in case of dental plaster, but spatiation, the breakage of hemihedral structure continuously takes increase in setting time. Exactly, that's the question I've asked you. And what about the question I asked you? I think only Abhishek has answered. Abhishek, Nidhi. Hi, Kanishka. A very good evening. Hi, Pooja. Don't worry, we'll summarize once again, okay? Yeah. Yeah, I asked you one question, right? So prolonged spatulation increases working time and setting time in case of zinc phosphate cement, but it decreases the same in case of gypsum products. Why? Because it was asked several times in previous sentence also. No, not applying Vaseline over the zinc phosphate cement. You lute, assume that you have a crown, you have a prepared tooth, you fill the crown half with the luting cement, you place the crown over the prepared tooth, the margins should be protected from moisture contamination, the margins of the crown. You can apply a varnish or a Vaseline or any petroleum jelly which isolates the external environment from that of zinc phosphate cement. Hi Sahithi, are we talking about the setting time, working time? Yes, and also setting expansion. Why do you think there is increase in setting expansion, Sahithi? By the way, you're right. Yeah. Okay, let me just clarify that for you. In case of gypsum products, we have this nuclei of crystallization, the nuclei. So once you prolong the spatulation, more number of nuclei are created. So there can be accelerated setting and decrease in setting time because of formation of more nuclei which act as a catalyst. Just assume that way. So prolonged spatulation in gypsum products can increase the density of nuclei of crystallization, which increases the rate of reaction, thus decreasing the setting time in case of gypsum products. But in case of zinc phosphate cement, prolonging spatulation breaks the matrix which is being formed. The matrix is nothing but your zinc aluminum phosphate gel matrix embedded in, which is incorporating unreacted zinc oxide particles. That matrix is being broken because of prolonged spatulation. As a result, it takes more time to reform the matrix, hence there is increase in working as well as setting time in case of zinc phosphate cement. So that's the contrast and difference we have with respect to increased spatulation in case of zinc phosphate cement and gypsum products. I hope it's clear. Hi Sanchita, yeah sure, I'll definitely summarize. I'm just waiting for a few minutes so that I can take up your questions. I'll definitely summarize, and that's the best part of my entire presentation, I feel. I mean, I enjoy summarizing because all this, you listen or you don't listen, you'll definitely get a lot many points. But summary is like, it's like take home messages. It's like right on target, isn't it? Hi Avinish, a very good evening. Yeah, so I hope it's clear, right? With respect to prolonged spatulation, right? Let's just give me 1 minute, I'll have some water, and I will just conclude with the summary, okay? Right. Right, so that's how it doesn't come. Exactly, Zeno. Right, so zinc phosphate cement is a gold standard cement, and it's the oldest known luting cement. It's also called as crown and bridge cement, right? And by the way, zinc phosphate cement is a water-based cement, and the ABS specification number for water-based cement is 96. So 96 is the ABS specification number for any water-based cement. And ISO number is 9917, right? So you have ADA specification number as well as ISO number. So as we have been discussing regarding the composition, so we have powder liquid. Powder chiefly contains zinc oxide, and liquid chiefly contains water and phosphoric acid. And phosphoric acid 33 plus or minus 5 by weight percentage, right? And the basic reaction is an acid-base reaction which happens in presence of water. Water controls the ionization of cement, thereby controlling the rate of reaction. And setting can be altered by presence of water or addition of water or loss of water, right? And also, the working time is 1.52 minutes. So it's approximately 1.52 minutes. Like we can say, to be more accurate, it's a mixing time cum working time. And the amount of time which is allotted for mixing each increment is 15 to 20 seconds, and the setting time is 2.5 to 8 minutes, right? And also the powder liquid ratio recommended. Powder 1.4 grams and liquid 0.5 mL. And also we've seen regarding the means through which we can increase the working and setting time. So we can increase the working and setting time by, as you can see, by decreasing the powder liquid ratio, by adding up cement in increments, or by prolonging spatulation, or the most commonly implemented means is by cooling the glass slab. These are the means through which we can increase the working as well as setting time. And also you'll see in the structure of a set cement where there is formation of zinc aluminum phosphate gel in an, it's an amorphous kind of matrix containing unreacted zinc oxide as filler particles, right? And also we're seeing regarding few physical properties. So compressive strength 104 MPa, so it is higher comparatively, right? Tensile strength is low, 5.5, and elastic modulus of stiffness is comparatively high, and solubility is low comparatively. So comparative in the sense, we have to compare this with other cements and try to analyze. We have a separate table comparing all these properties, various gentle cements, and that's very, very important, right? And also we discussed about the biological properties. pH initially is 2, within 24 hours it's 5.5, and also retention, it's mechanical retention, and also we discussed about manipulation part as well, right? So this is in brief the entire summary, and remember the main purpose of zinc phosphate cement clinical applications. As you know, it can be used as a luting cement or it can be used as a base material. And also we discussed about the thickness, film thickness of any luting cement as per ADA specification has to be less than 25 microns, right? And the purpose of luting cement is to not to increase the retention of a crown, but to seal the interface primarily. So these are very, very important, right? So this is in brief about zinc phosphate cement. I hope it's clear. So you have any further questions, let me know. And as I said, we'll break it here, right? So we'll break it here and we'll have another separate link where we shall go proceed with the textbook discussion followed by MCQs discussion, right? GIC or zinc phosphate better luting cement? So obviously you have the answer with you. So even though zinc phosphate is considered as a gold standard, but we do prefer GIC clinically, because GIC we can achieve film thickness, type 1 GIC we can achieve film thickness of 25 microns or less, and most importantly GIC has this chemical bonding. So if you say clinical orientation, which is the best cement available for luting, we obviously say GIC, glass enamel cement. It can range, it has to be less than 25. There are cements which have thickness of 25 to 40. We have this categorization, but according to ADA, luting cement, the film thickness has to be less than 25 microns. Yeah, yes, Arnish. Okay, right. Ashina, if you have mechanical and micromechanical. Okay, just answer this question for me, Ashina. Composite, does it have micromechanical retention or mechanical retention? So it's a challenging question, isn't it? So composite, we say micromechanical. So zinc phosphate, as mentioned in your textbook, it is mechanical. But as given in latest literature, since phosphoric acid is present, I just gave you that for sake of additional information, but not with an intention to confuse you, right? If in case you have both options, yeah, select both. If you have that option of selecting both options like A and B or B and C, or if you have only one option to choose, then go for mechanical as it's given in your FIPS. Anyways, good question, Ashina. Right. Okay. So I hope it's clear, the entire summary. We still have few additional points to discuss over the textbook discussion, right? So we'll just take another 15-20 minutes covering that and we'll proceed with MCQ's discussion. Yeah, yes, Nidhi, you're right. It's composite micromechanical, amalgam is purely mechanical. And GIC is chemical, isn't it? Okay then? Right. Yeah, textbook discussion from Phillips, right. So it's 9:42. We'll see you all by 10 to 10. I mean 9:50. Okay, in another 8 minutes, we'll be live again by 9:50. Okay, is it fine, 9:50? Okay. Yeah. 7 minutes remaining. Yeah. In fact, I have to rearrange, so that would be sufficient for me. Yes, no, Abhishek, right. So we'll break that. See you again. So we'll have a dance show by Toffee, followed by the next live session. Okay, right. See you. Bye. No, we can expect 30 minutes, it's 8 minutes, it's 9:43 now, we'll be back by 9:50, so 7 more minutes. Okay, bye.